You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download.
So now I'll do some work on the screen right side. I had to hand animate my head core shapes. You can see there isn't any tracking data down here in the timeline for these shapes. So here in the screen right upper head core and lower, there's nothing in the data area here, just my manual keyframes. But I can create a tracked layer by utilizing control points on a shape. And that's why it's so important to keep the points in the same place while keyframing. So I'm going to choose a couple points up here. I'll select this point and control command this point. I'm going to go to the tracker tab and be in the point track section and right click. And when I right click, you can see I can either create a track from points from the shape center or corner trackers from the shape bounds. And I'm going to create a tracker from points. So now you can see I have two trackers here. And they're following the side of the head, but I need to make my layer. So they're selected here and I can click apply. And then I want to make sure that position and rotation is included because I want that rotation information, but I don't want scaling because that can make the shape a little bit crazy. Click OK, and now I have my layer here. And I can call this screen right upper. We'll call these open shapes. I'll make some open shapes here. And I can just turn off my trackers and we can start making some shapes. Click Escape and R. And now we can see that once my shape is dropped in, it's following pretty well. I have to do some animating, but not a ton because it's already attached to the side of the head. So we've taken out that movement that I have to accommodate for. And there's still going to be some keyframes because the hair is blowing around. Okay, so that's a really handy way to create a tracked layer from control points. So one last thing I want to show you here before we look at my final project is how to create a variable width open shape. I'm going to turn off this shape here and I'm going to go to this layer where I've already created a tracked layer from control points again. And I'm going to turn on my shape here. I've already done some animation to save some time. So here I have a piece of hair that's thick at the top and very thin at the bottom. If I turn off the overlays by clicking zero, you can see that this piece of hair is thick and then thin. So I've rotoed it just with an open shape. I can see what's going on. But now I'm going to assign a thickness. I'm going to go down to my stroke width area here. I'm going to start with 3. And now you can see I have the width here. I'm going to zoom in. And I'm actually going to change the width in different areas. I'm going to click Alt F. And that's going to bring up the feather handles and the stroke width handles here. So on the right, you can see if I click this, if I pull out that my stroke is getting larger. Or that the width is getting larger. But what I want to do, I'm going to undo that because I want to make sure that it's going to be the same across the keyframe. So I have to use the multiframe tool and that's press M or click this icon over here on the left. And now it's whatever changes I make is going to affect all the keyframes I've made. And the handle on the left, the green handle, that is the feather handle, but we're not going to do any feathering just yet. Feathering is something that I usually save for the very last, if I need to do it at all. And then down here at the end of the stroke, it's a couple things you can do. You can have a variation on a cap style. You can go flat or round. I'm just going to keep this at flat. Or you can just pinch it in and make a point. I'm going to go out of the multiframe tool, click M. And now you can see that my shape is animating. Sometimes the tip gets a little bit odd. It doesn't quite stay a point. But for the most part, you can now see that the shape is changing. Looks like we had one keyframe here where it was a little bit. I may have changed that a little bit, but that's okay. I'm just going to delete this. And now it's matched up. Click M just to make another edit. Just do some refining. And then we can even check for some motion blur. So we have to enable motion blur on the shape here. And down here in the node, in the motion blur section, click enable. And then we're going to turn off the overlays. Click A. It's easier to see just in black and white. And now you can see we have some motion blur. If it's not quite as refined as we like, if you see the little banding, you can always up your samples to 32. But this is really the last thing you would ever do. And you might not want to hand off your Roto with motion blur checked anyhow. You might want to disable that because that might be something that's turned on in the compositing process. But it's a good way to check. I'm going to go back to color, turn our overlays back on. And then the other thing we can try is the feathering. If you want an even softer fall off, you can use this green handle here. I'm going to click M for multiframe, and we'll just open that up a little bit. You can see there's this dotted line around my shape. And that's the feathering. And that's going to also increase the rendering time if you have that checked on as well as motion blur. Go to the multiframe tool and go back to our alpha overlay. And we have more softness here, as you can see. And we can even blur the shape a little bit too. And there we go. We'll go back to color and turn our overlays back on. Okay, before we move on to look at my final Roto, you just want to make sure that when you're done looking at your alpha with motion blur turned on, that you turn it off. You go back to the node and disable this box here, because if you keep this on and you keep rotoing, it slows down silhouette a lot, just as calculating all the motion blur with the Roto. And we'll go over motion blur more in depth in the next class.